Blessed Redeemer, sing, oh earth, His wonderful love proclaim. Praise Him, praise Him, tell of His excellent grace. Praise Him, ever in joyful
praise.
Give the Lord a hand this morning. At this time, let's greet one another this morning.
Be seated.
Morning.
Good. Please be seated. Thank you. Welcome to the First Baptist Church of Lake Panasoffkee. Today is 24 March, Palm Sunday. Save the day reminder, Vacation Bible School will be this summer from July 15th to July 19th. The theme is scuba, diving with the friendship of God, something that we all need. Sign-up sheet is in the foyer. A reminder with Shoebox Ministry. Shoebox Ministry is asking for socks for 2 to 4 years old, as well as washcloths. If you have any questions, please talk to Ms. Suzanne. Tonight's growth group is continuing a new series entitled How We Got to the Bible. Snacks are at 5:30 and the study starts at 6. Next Sunday, Easter. Sunrise service starts at 7:30. The potluck breakfast is at 8:15. Growth groups at 9. Morning worship and the Lord's Supper is at 10. There will be no evening growth groups, and also on that morning there will be no Lighthouse Cafe. We have a sign-up sheet out in the foyer for that Sunday for the breakfast. We need help with the cleanup if you want to provide for the breakfast dishes as well as for cleanup. Right now there's nobody really signing up for cleanup, so if you could, please volunteer and sign up. Also, March 31st is the praise offering. April 2nd is the after-school program that begins. Asking for volunteers, if you could, please see Miss Sally Burgess. She'll be more than happy to help you. April 6th is the bow shoot from 8 a.m. to noon. April 13th is the mission breakfast from 8 o'clock to 10 o'clock. I recall seeing Dan up here a couple weeks ago, and he's spot on. One, there is great fellowship, and two, you can't beat the amount of food that you get. A lot of good, delicious food. April 14th, we have a guest speaker, Tommy Green, who will be here. And on the same Sunday, that afternoon, we have the council meeting dinner at 5 o'clock, and the council meeting is at 6 o'clock. For those who are new or unfamiliar, on Sunday morning, we have growth groups that starts at 9 o'clock. We have different groups for men, women, family, youth, and children. We also have on Wednesday night Bible study that is led by pastor that begins with a study and ends with prayer. We also have men's and women's night growth groups, as well as on Wednesday nights we have different groups for children with Kid Venture. We have middle school for Youth Venture, and we also have the youth with Miss Amanda. For those here in the audience, if you're a first-time visitor or a guest, we ask that you fill out the connection card. Just fill it out. It's easy to tear off, and if you could, just put it in the offering plate, or we also have a brown box in the back. For those who are online through Facebook, we ask that you click the like or click like and share. The videos on Facebook, we post current messages, pastors' Wednesday night studies, as well as encouraging words throughout the week. For those who are watching on YouTube, we also ask that you like and subscribe and share the current as well as past messages. At this time, if the deacons, jokes, fellows, and ushers come forward, we'll do the offering. This week's Yokes Fellow is Brother Richard Reaver. If you could, do the prayer, please.
And be lifted up, O ancient doors, that the King of glory may come in. Who is the King of glory? The Lord strong and mighty, the Lord mighty in battle. Lift up your heads, O gates, and lift them up, O ancient doors, that the King of glory may come in. Who is this King of glory? The Lord of hosts. He is the King of glory.
sing it with us. Come. We prepare for you this morning. We prepare our hearts to see you move in this place today. Lord, we bless your name this morning. In the land of plenty and even in the wilderness, Father, you are good and your mercy endures forever. We bless your name this morning. Let's sing it again.
Blessed be your name. Land that is plentiful, where streams of abundance flow. Blessed be your name. Blessed be your name. And found in the desert place, where I walk through the wilderness. Blessed be your name.
Every blessing.
Every blessing you pour out, I'll turn back to praise. When the darkness closes in, Lord, still I will say, blessed be the name of the Lord, blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord, blessed be your glorious name.
Every blessing
you pour out, I'll turn back to praise. When the darkness closes in, Lord, still I will say, blessed be the name of the Lord, blessed be your name. to be a glorious name.
Scripture says God gives and He takes away, and He's blessed forever. Amen? Sing this with me. You ready?
You give and take away. You give and take away. My heart will choose to say, well, blessed.
I think you got more in you. I want to hear it this morning.
You give and take away. You give and take away. My heart will choose to say, for blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your glory.
Amen. You may be seated for a second. Lord, indeed, we join with creation in singing your praise. Lord, for you are the maker of heaven and earth, the King of kings, the Lord of lords, the one who forgives our sin and our shame, the one who conquers death. Father, together this morning as we stand and sing, we raise our hands to sing hallelujah to your name, Hosanna in the highest. Praise to our Lord. Let's sing together this morning.
your presence.
They laid him down.
in Joseph's tomb, the entrance sealed by heavy stone, Messiah still and all alone. Oh, praise the name of the Lord our God. Oh, praise His name forevermore. For endless days we will sing. Son of heaven rose again. Oh, trampled land, where is your sting? The angels roar for Christ our King.
Come on, church, sing it. I love that thing. You ever feel like him?
The colonel's sitting outside in the trash heap trying to figure out how he got there. All of technology keeps rolling at you all the time. I was trying to get my cell phone to play music this morning and decided it didn't want to. But I got here and it did. One of the things that you and I need to look at and stop and think, and I appreciate everything that has gone on before in this pre-service. It just has aimed. You can see when the Holy Spirit has his hand on it. And it is aimed exactly at where we're going. Why do we sing? The reason for song. Okay, some of you have pieces of paper. Number one should read really good and loud.
Open to me the gates of righteousness. I will go through them and I will praise the Lord. This is the gate of the Lord, through which the righteous shall enter.
I praise you, for you have answered me and have become my salvation.
The stone which the builders rejected has become the chief cornerstone.
This was the Lord's doing. It is marvelous in our eyes.
This is the day the Lord has made. We will rejoice and be glad in it.
Save now, I pray, O Lord. O Lord, I pray, send now prosperity.
Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. We have blessed you from the house of the Lord.
God is the Lord, and he has given us life. Bind the sacrifice of the cords to the horns of the altar.
You are my God, and I will praise you. You are my God, I will exalt you.
Oh, give thanks to the Lord, for he is good, for his mercy endures forever.
This is the day. This is the day that the Lord has made, that the Lord has made. We will rejoice and be glad in it, and be glad in it. This is the day that the Lord has made. We will rejoice and be glad in it. This is the day. This is the day that the Lord has made. Have you ever sung that before?
Yes.
Some of you said no. How many of you have never sung that before? Wow. Okay. Well, I've sung that most of my life. And we often tie it to a good day. This is the day the Lord has made. I'll rejoice and be glad in it. That's today. That's great. That's not what it's talking about. It really isn't. The Messiah's presence, that is a representation of a gospel choir that you see up there in modern art. Okay? So I hope you get the point on that. This is the day sometimes we really do not understand what we're singing. One of the things in singing "This is the day" is for the Jews, they would come to the Passover, and as they would come up to Jerusalem, they would start singing, and probably not the way we sing it, but they would start singing from Psalm 118. This is the day the Lord has made. We will rejoice and be glad in it. One of the rabbis wrote, "You do not know joy until you've seen joy as people come up to Jerusalem singing the Hallel, Psalm 118. This is the day the Lord has made. We will rejoice and be glad in it." Well, what is that day? What's he talking about then? What is he bringing together? It, for 1,000 years, folks, before Jesus Christ came, this was sung in Israel. What it was a prediction that the Messiah is coming.
Amen.
And this is what really upset the Pharisees is because when they heard the crowd singing the Hallel, "This is the day the Lord has made. We will rejoice in it." The Pharisees understood that the crowd was proclaiming Christ, Messiah.
Amen.
They were going to follow him as king. They didn't want to hear that. And we know from the scriptures that they began to plot his death immediately. They'd been trying to figure out what to do with Christ before. They didn't know what to do. Now they said the whole world, and it's recorded, look, the whole world has gone after him. Well, Christ rode into Jerusalem through the Eastern Gate on a donkey, and you know that story. Every Palm Sunday that's shared across the world. But what it is Jesus Christ promised for over 1,000 years, and now he's here.
Amen.
You excited?
Amen.
He's here.
Amen.
Can you sense the crowd? Can you feel the crowd as they get so excited that the Messiah is finally here? Guys, there are two times in my mind where this really strikes at us. There was a little teenage Jewish girl that, along with her sisters throughout the history of Israel, had prayed, "May I bear the body of the Messiah." That's the prayer that little Jewish girls were taught. That prayer finally came to fruition. And as it did, it's mind-blowing. The Hamilton Free Translation of Mary's response is, "Who, me?" This is the day the Messiah is going to come, and you're going to bear his body. Now, in Psalm 118, and folks, all over this world, Jewish people, today, I don't mean the date today, but the modern day, still read Psalm 118 at their Passover Seders. They do that. We've got great news. That day came 2,000 years ago.
Amen.
Jesus Christ came. This is the day.
Yes.
Folks, I hope you get excited about it. I know we go through Palm Sunday, and I love that little video that they used on Palm Sunday because it really encapsulates the whole thing. And people put in their cloaks in the road, the palm branches. Folks, I don't know if you understand the significance of all of that, but the crowds were proclaiming Jesus Christ King, Jesus Christ Messiah. He is finally here. Well, it's called the Great Hallel. It's up to Pastor Randy to give you the other end of the really good news. But all this week, they're examining the Lamb. I don't even have time to go into that. I shouldn't start that. But we found out, and we'll find out, that he is fit to be the sacrifice for you and for me, that our sins might be forgiven. And the moment that they took the lamb, cut its throat, caught its blood in a bowl, and laid it on the altar, Christ was on that cross.
at that moment. I believe that from the geography of Israel, he could have seen the priest do it. You know what else they were doing? The singers in Israel were singing Psalm 118. This is the day the Lord has made. We will rejoice and be glad in it. They didn't even understand what they were singing. That is the most momentous event that history has ever seen.
Amen.
And 3 days later, Pastor Randy will tell you. But when we sing, "This is the day the Lord has made," I want you to understand, you and I are grateful every day we get, and we're grateful for the day and good days and all that stuff. And we praise the Lord for the hard days as well as the good, and I appreciate that song. Thank you. We appreciate all of that. But the fact is, this song does not refer to us, our good days or bad days. It refers to the Messiah is here. That's it. That's the presentation. That's Palm Sunday. Do you understand? And this is a completely different message, and I can't bring it in today. That the day that Christ rode into Jerusalem was predicted over 400 years before.
Amen.
The day, the date. God crafted Israel, history. It's all, he put it together, and there it was. This is the day. Well, the Bible tells us in 2 Peter 3:9, God is not slack concerning his promise. The Lord isn't really being slow. This is the NLT. The Lord isn't really being slow about his promise, as some people think. No, he is being patient for your sake. He does not want anyone to be destroyed, but wants everybody to come to repentance. For 1,000 years, the Jews had sung, "This is the day the Lord has made. We'll rejoice and glad in it." And they had done it at Passover. Now, after 1,000 years, there it is, right in front of them. And we look back 2,000 years later at the historicity of this thing that just is so momentous it blows your mind.
Amen.
Yeah, Palm Sunday, I know. We have our traditions that we go through, and that's okay. I'm not against those traditions. But it's not about us. It's about him.
Amen.
The Messiah's presence. Well, let's take a look at Psalm 118. If you have your scriptures, I encourage you to open them. We're going to be studying verses 19 to 29. Let's just bow in a quick word of prayer. Lord, we come to you understanding that we don't understand. You are phenomenal. You are awesome. And all of history is his story. I pray, Heavenly Father, today that if there is anybody here within the sound of this voice that does not know Christ as their Savior, that they would accept him before this day is over. Lord, may it be their day of meeting the Messiah. I ask all this in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, one of the great joys of the day was Christ came down over the top of the mountain and right into the eastern gates. There's 100 things I could tell you about that. I have to keep on focus. I never get off focus. The triumphal entry is told in verse 19 and 20. Open to me the gates of righteousness, and I will go through them. I will praise the Lord. This is the gate of the Lord through which the righteous shall enter. Did you know that the Muslims put a cemetery in front of the Eastern Gate, and they boarded the Eastern Gate up in Jerusalem so nobody can come in that gate again? You think that's going to stop Christ when he comes back the second time? Nope. He came through that the first time, and they understood it. Even the Muslims understood the promises that were given. Do they believe them? No. But do they understand them? Yes, they do. And they said, we're going to prevent him from coming back. Yeah. The triumphal entry is given to us. You understand Psalms is written approximately, give or take a little bit, 1000 B.C. Okay? And we're talking about it 2,000 years later. So 3,000 years ago, God told us he's going to come through the gate. Well, it goes on. The Messiah has become our salvation in verse 21. I will praise you, for you have answered me and have become what? My salvation. That person that's going to go through that gate is going to save me. Isn't that marvelous? God doesn't want you to spend eternity in hell. There's a sign in Citrus County, and some of you may have seen it. It's on, I think, was it 486 or whatever the highway is, Norville Bryan Highway. Great big sign says, eternity in hell is a long time. Ooh, that's been there. I've been here since 1986. That's been there ever since, and the guy maintains that sign. It's a huge sign. It's probably over 10 feet long and 6-8 feet high. I don't know how. But it sure gets a message across, doesn't it? Christ loves you so much, he does not want you to spend eternity in hell. Amen. He doesn't want you there. He's not slack concerning his promise. They were praying for the coming of the Messiah that would save them. You understand, salvation is always by faith. Always. Even in the Old Testament, it was faith in a promise. Hebrews 11 tells you that. It was faith in a promise. We sit here with the advantage of history. We look back and we have faith in a historical event. How do we know about it? God told us. How did they know about in the Old Testament that it was going to happen? God told them. Amen. Well, the Messiah has become our salvation. And then verse 22, this is one that you could preach a whole series of messages on. The stone which the builders rejected has become the chief cornerstone. When you get done, and we're going to go to Matthew, not right now. We're going to go to Matthew. And the Pharisees understood when Christ quoted these scriptures, he was talking about them. You see, Christ never read the book, How to Win Friends and Influence People. He told the truth, period. I do want you to turn to Matthew 21. We have to be out by noon, right? You should have seen some of the looks I just got. If you're new around here, you don't know I pull your leg a lot. Okay? Matthew 21, 42. Jesus said to them, did you never read the scriptures? Who's he talking to? Pharisees. And he said, did you never read the scriptures? If you're a Pharisee, how would you feel about that statement? What do you mean? I study them all day long. That's my job. Well, they missed something. And then he quotes for them Psalm 118. The stone which the builders rejected has become the chief cornerstone. This is the Lord's doing, and it is marvelous in our eyes. Listen, they knew that by heart. They were part of the crowds that would come up to Jerusalem during Passover, and they would chant or sing this on the way up. So Christ's question to them actually was an insult. Don't you guys understand? Well, of course, every year I come up to Jerusalem, actually three times a year, we chant this. In verse 43, he said, therefore I say to you, the kingdom of God will be taken from you, the Pharisees, and given to a nation bearing fruits of it. And whoever falls on this stone will be broken, but on whom it falls, it will grind him to powder. Take a look at verse 45. Now when the chief priests and Pharisees heard his parables, what? What was the next phrase? Yeah, you're talking about us. Hey, you talking about me? How did they react to it? Well, they wanted to take him then, but they're afraid of the people. The Pharisees really did understand. In verse 22, it's a stone that's rejected. Who rejected the stone? The Pharisees did. There's a whole nother discussion. By the way, what does it mean when I look at my watch? Absolutely nothing. Okay, just as long as you understand. He confronted the Pharisees. Let me give this to you really quickly. I don't even have time to go through it. Christ is the rock that is stricken, that the spirit of life may flow from him to all who drink. To the church, he's the foundation and chief cornerstone. To the Jews, his first coming was a stumbling stone. To Israel, at the second coming, he's the capstone. To the Gentile world and powers, he's the smiting rock cut out, but not with human hands. There's verses of scripture with all these. In the divine purpose, the stone which, after the destruction of the Gentile world, power is to grow and fill the earth, according to Daniel 2. And then to unbelievers, he's the crushing stone that will fall on them. Wow. Is he the stone? Yeah. Amen. Did the Pharisees reject him? Yeah. They understood that he was talking about them. You guys have rejected the one that came. Well, in verse 23, back in Psalm 118, this is the Lord's doing. It is marvelous in our eyes. God's plan. You understand, things don't happen in this world by accident. There's just a, this is tongue in cheek, don't take me seriously. There was in the 1950s and 60s a famous theologian who didn't believe the Bible. And he said that Christ's birth was an accident because a Jewish girl went into a German war camp and got pregnant. God doesn't deal in accidents. Amen. He told them 1,000 years, this is coming. It's coming. It's coming. Well, the Lord's blessing. This is from the Lord. Salvation has as its author God. That's what it tells us here. God is the author. I want you to just listen. I'm going to read for you Hebrews 12, verse 2. Looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith. He's the one that put your salvation together. He was the one that paid for it. He was the one that walked the face of this earth for 33 years and didn't have to do that. Amen.
Was he more comfortable in heaven?
Yeah.
Yes, he was. But he loved you so much he came to walk the face of this earth. To be rejected by his own people, whom he loved dearly, and die for people that would mock him. Wow. This is the day the Lord has made. I will rejoice and be glad in it. He's come. Well, we see it and are astounded. Guys, I'm going to tell you, there's no preacher in this world. There's no theologian in this world that can adequately express the love of God. He did all of this for you. Did you know that when he went to that cross, you were on his mind? Guys, if that doesn't blow you away, I don't know what's going to. He did what you couldn't do. He died for your sins and paid the penalty for them. The Messiah's promise in verses 25 to 29. Let me just read it for you very quickly. Save now, I pray, O Lord. O Lord, I pray, send now prosperity. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. We have blessed you from the house of the Lord. God is the Lord, and he has given us light. Bind the sacrifice with cords to the horns of the altar. You know what that means? When they brought the sacrifice, they would literally tie, there were horns on the altar. They literally tie it there until they were ready to go ahead and offer it. He said, we're coming to worship. We're coming because he has given his life for us. Well, he goes on to say in verse 29 or 28, you are my God, I will praise you. You are my God, I will exalt you. Oh, give thanks to the Lord, for he is good, for his mercy endures forever. Well, the process of the promise of his coming is here. We live in the promise of his coming. The process of salvation was promised. He told us that he's going to do it. In the Old Testament, he said he's going to do it. In the New Testament, he says he did it for you and for me. Well, the product of salvation's promise comes down to who Jesus Christ is. There was a lady that was teaching kindergarten in a Christian school, and she had the beginning of the school year, and the kids were coming, and she wanted to find out how much the kids knew. You know, where am I going to start with these kids? And there was a little boy that obviously had no acquaintance with the Bible or with religion in any form. And so she took two sticks and put them together. And she explained to that little boy that Jesus Christ died on the cross for his sins. He was nailed to the cross. And the little boy dropped his head. And he said, oh, that's too bad. But she kept going with the rest of the story. 3 days later, he rose again. He lives again. He is God in human flesh. And the little kid said, totally awesome! Well, I'm glad we're not a, oh, that's too bad sign. I'm glad that this morning, by God's grace, you can be totally awesome because of who God is. Go ahead. That's who God is, folks. He came. We were told that he was coming. Well, my sins have been paid for. I couldn't do it, but he did. He had to be the perfect Lamb of God. He is God in human flesh. The kid was right. Totally awesome. And he died for your sins and mine. And I like verse 29 in Psalm 118. His mercy endures. Try it again. His mercy endures. Isn't that great? That's totally awesome. Well, there's a reason we sing. The Messiah's promise is here. His promise is relationship to the process of salvation, because his promise, and then the product of salvation's promise. And you and I sit here today as a result of what he has done and what he planned before the world was created.
Amen.
He saw you before you were ever born. He saw you down through the ages of time. And he said, I love you. And too many times, and I'm guilty, I love people. I love you guys. You just make me feel at home. Well, thank you. And Pastor Randy and Debbie have been just good friends down through, I guess, over a decade now. But I got to tell you, we say I love you and mean it from our heart, but it can't compare to what he said on the cross. I love you. And he proved it. The reason for the song is that the Messiah has come and we are saved by faith in him. This is the day, this is the day that the Lord has made, that the Lord has made. We will rejoice, we will rejoice and be glad in it, and be glad in it. This is the day that the Lord has made. We will rejoice and be glad in it. This is the day, this is the day that the Lord has made. You really believe that? Can you say hallelujah? We ought to be able to do that with them. 2,000 years ago, as they proclaimed the presence of the Messiah. Do you know the presence of the Messiah in your life? Have you come to God and told him in prayer, Lord, I know I'm a sinner. I agree with the Bible. I know I can't be good enough to save myself, because there's not one of us that can. Bible says, for all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. If you have not accepted Christ as your own personal Savior, you miss the whole purpose of his coming. He loved you so much that he paid a price that you couldn't pay to give you a home that you couldn't purchase. With every head bowed and every eye closed, Lord, we've come to you this morning understanding that we don't deserve anything that you've done, and yet you have given us salvation. That Jesus Christ rode that donkey through the eastern gates of Jerusalem to face the Passion Week. And that he would die on the cross. But praise the Lord, he would rise again on the third day. Lord, if there's anyone here without Christ as their Savior, please, Father, do not let them leave this place until they've come to know Christ as their own personal Savior. Just keep your heads bowed, and I want believers to be praying. Let me ask you, do you know if you were to die today, right now, this moment, that you'd go to be with Jesus? If you do, just raise your hand. I don't do that, folks, to find out who did or didn't. I do that to make you make a decision. If you could not raise your hand before, are you willing to come to God in prayer and say, Lord, I know I'm a sinner. I know I can never be good enough to save myself. And I'm asking Jesus Christ alone to take me to heaven when I die. If you've never done that before, but you just did it now, would you just quietly raise your hand? Let me pray with you. I'm not going to call you out. But we want everyone to know they're going to be in heaven with God. This is the day you meet the Master. You meet the Savior. Will there be any this morning? Father, as we come to you, we do thank you. Beyond human ability to try and understand your love for us. Father, let us rejoice in this day. Let us be glad in it, for the Messiah has come. I ask all this in Christ's name. Amen.
I'll do something a little different than what we normally do. I just want to end with a song of praise together. So let's stand and sing this morning.
Front. Any questions?
Am I here moving in our midst? I worship you. I worship you. You are here working in this place. I worship you. Worship you. You are here, moving in our midst. I worship you. I worship you. You are here, working in this place. I worship you.
Light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. You are way maker, miracle work, promise keeper. Light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. God's moving on your heart. Just come.
Touching every heart, I worship you. I worship you. You are here, healing every heart. I worship you. I worship you. I worship you. I worship you.
This dear lady just confirmed something I was going to tell you. I stand before you a miracle. I had a stroke 3.5 weeks ago. It landed in my legs. That's the reason I asked him to bring this down on the floor. I want to give God the glory. Amen. I am so grateful for your prayers
And I ask that you continue to pray that God will complete his miracle in my life. But I'm back on my feet and able to walk. And that's a miracle all by itself. And I just, I didn't want to say anything beforehand because I am not the important one here. He is. But I want to say thank you to the church. I thank you for the prayers that you send up, and I ask you for this moment, please do not stop. Okay? I'd appreciate it. Dan, would you dismiss us in a word of prayer?